Yeah, please silence your devices and stuff. I don't have a hashtag to tweet if you guys wanted to tweet. So, I'm sorry about that. So, my name is Delana. I'm the librarian at the Ralph J. Bunche Center for African American Studies. This is the Black Forum.
Silence the device.
It's silencing. So today we're doing a screening of Warrior. As you see, the life of Leonard Peltier, who is a 72-year-old American Indian Movement political prisoner, who's also an artist. He's serving two life sentences, and we're gonna watch the documentary, and then afterwards we're going to have a discussion about it. So I'm going to have Shannon and Nolan just say a couple of words to you, and then we're going to jump into the screen. So this is Shannon Rivers. I'm sorry, I don't know how to pronounce your tribe.
Akhmir Othman. You can say it.
Akhmir Othman.
There you go. Perfect.
From the Gila River community, and he is a graduate student in American Indian Studies. So he's going to give words.
Good afternoon. Really quickly, I wanted to, first of all, apologize for Kathy Peltier. She's not going to be able to make it. Like most of us, I think we're suffering from a little cold that's going around. But what you're going to witness is a culmination of events that took place in the 60s and 70s. I was a tiny, tiny boy then, but I grew up in this kind of violence on the reservation, and Clementine saying, sure. I was probably about 7 years old when this thing happened. And as a result of this violence and how it if we look at what's happening today, violence against indigenous peoples in general and people of color is a continuation of colonization, policy, legislation, police state, policing in Indian country and in this United States. So what you'll witness is the story of Peltier. I never met him. I have done a couple of things on committees to try to get him eradicated out of prison. In 2009-10, we established a tribunal to bring back all the parties that were involved during this time. At that time, you'll see Dino Butler in the film. Dino Butler went in isolation, self-seclusion. Bob Rubidoux moved away to Italy and never returned. He actually eventually died some years ago in Italy. But some of these people that you see have since passed on. But many of the, unfortunately, Peltier is still in prison in Florida. And the United States and the Bureau of Justice, the FBI, wage a heavy, heavy campaign about keeping him in prison. As you will notice that through the evidence that's going to be presented in the film is that nearly every evidence against Peltier has been false or been manufactured by the United States government and the justice system. The Federal Bureau of Investigations, there's still an active campaign. Every few years, the families of those that the two FBI agents that were killed still wage a heavy campaign with whatever administrations involved to deny clemency for Peltier. So we'll talk more about it. I want to get the film going. try to understand that this situation is not just a Peltier story, but it's an indigenous story. And what happens today about indigenous peoples, black and brown, who are incarcerated at high rates, and how we participate in our blind justice of even our own people. So I want to thank you guys, and we'll be back.
I thank you, Shannon, for that, and I'm honored and thrilled that some of the Bruin Aid now is here and co-sponsoring this wonderful event because, as Shannon said, this is a native issue. While at the same time, one reason why I'm fighting so hard to get land out of business, it's 77, 78 days left, is because he's not only a native icon. I had somebody yesterday who actually created the Black and American Indian Congress, the National Congress, and he said that he considers, they consider him an elder. Natives consider him an elder in many of the communities. But he was an ally and still is to Black Panthers. He worked for the Black Panthers. And I truly believe 100% that if Peltier is, I will not use the word free, because if you were a person of color in the country, especially Black or Native, you were not free. But if he is pardoned, it will move the movement at large for, throughout, I don't know, 50 years. It'd be like giving the movement steroids, because, like Shannon said, the federal government, and this probably is the most powerful government in the history of mankind, for them to lose at this would be huge. And as you'll see in this film, like Shannon said, the reason he was targeted by law enforcement before the occupation of Wounded Knee is because he was an indigenous person trying to help his people. That's the only reason. I didn't know this until this morning. Jasmine Abdullah, who is of Black Lives Matter Los Angeles, she is a parole officer. She hasn't broken the law. All she's done is trying to fight for our people. That's it. And she's a parole officer. Or someone like Brock Turner, who sexually assaulted a woman, is out of prison. So, jail, when you're in prison, is more than you. So, this is, and also, this is an amazing film by Susie Barrett, who's a part of our collective trying every single day to get Leonard out. And you will enjoy the film from a cinematic standpoint, and you will learn a lot if you don't know about the case. Even if you do, there's so many great points being made the whole film, and it covers both sides, even though this is a right or wrong type of issue. So let's all enjoy this.
So you just watched the case of Peltier kind of played out. As it mentioned in the film, there were senators, spiritual representatives, people from all over the world, political, social, environmental activists who have called for Leonard's release. But as you can see, that he still is in prison. In 2008, I mentioned that we established, along with the Leonard Peltier Defense Committee, a tribunal in Wisconsin on the Oneida Reservation. And we called Dino Butler to come out, and he came out. And he gave, again, the same story that you see here. So no stories have changed. The only stories that have changed is the ones with the FBI. And they constantly go back and forth on who was the shooter. There was a group of seven, there was a group of three, they targeted three, the guns didn't match. There's so much evidence against them that they're lying in this case. But today, I just got off the phone, and I was showing my brother back there, Jean Roach. She is, she has the official page, she runs the official page for Leonard Peltier's committee on Facebook. And she was 14 at the time when the shootout happened. And she's a friend of mine, but she always talks about that trauma that happened then, and that fear that even exists today. And what you see is that fear being played out at Standing Rock. That it is the culmination of colonization, 200 years in some cases, 400 years in many places, and the structural violence that is committed against indigenous peoples. And every one of us play a role in that violence if we keep our eyes closed. Most of us look at justice and we think that justice is just gonna happen. But the question is whose justice are we looking for? Are we looking for individual justice? Are we looking at a justice that is a colonial system? And that system is predicated on whiteness. We talked about this the other day with some friends, that it is a system that is not for the benefit of people of color. Many of our people in South Dakota, for example, and we're in South and North Dakota, where indigenous peoples are about 8 to 10% of the population, nearly 60% of the criminal cases is what basically is running the court system now. And so we have thousands or hundreds of people being arrested over the weekend and the last couple of weeks, being put in kennels, being put in cages. There, about 2 months ago, to bail somebody out of Standing Rock was $500, today is $1,500. Mm-hmm. They impound your car, it's $800. It could anywhere to $1,000. It's basically a kind of free-for-all. So what does this matter? What does Peltier's case matter to us? I mean, Obama's got 70-something days left or so, if that. And sadly, during the time, and I will say this on camera, when we were talking to the Clinton administration, the FBI, Clinton had the pardon on his desk.
Oh.
And he had it on his desk. But the FBI then discovered Monica Lewinsky. So there's a lot of political play. Now, I'm not saying that those are, you know, some of the reasonings, but if we know anything about the FBI and what they've been doing, they're pretty sneaky folks, right? And so what does it matter that Peltier is still in prison? It matters a lot to indigenous peoples. He is our Gandhi to some. He is our Mandela to some. He is a warrior who fought for the rights of indigenous people. These are inherent rights. They're not rights given. But elders always tell us that we just don't have rights. We have responsibilities. And that's what you saw Leonard doing. Is he had a responsibility as a warrior to step up, to fight, and to protect the people. And in the jumping bull compound, there was more women and elders and children there. And a warrior is led to protect that. And you could be a warrior too, all of you are warriors. But it's the level of warriorism that you want to display. And some of us don't know how to do that in this colonial system. We go to school and we get educated and we kind of disappear. But for someone like myself who's been involved since I was a kid, because my brothers were killed during this time, they mentioned reservation murders or res murders, if you guys remember that term. There was res murders going all over the place. Arizona, you know, Oklahoma, all over, happening. Two of my brothers were killed in 77, a month apart. Nobody ever, you know, I was just talking to Pauline about the violence still in our community. These are things that the pillars of colonialism have built, and they still destroy us in a way that it is very difficult for us to climb out. We want to go to school and we want to get educated, but my education, this one guy, you're one person, we don't leave our families behind. We're always trying to bring our families with us because we want them to have a better life. And that's what Peltier, the American Indian Movement, has done. And when I was a boy, they came to my house when my brother was killed. And I was given a patch when I was really little. And back then, you just wrote American Indian Movement on a patch. And I buried that with my dad when he died, because my dad died with a broken heart, right? But so I have a patch today, and I wear that with pride. And as an American Indian Movement member, I wear that stuff because that's a symbolism. It's a remembrance of who we are as Native people. And so for us that sit here and we see a film like this and the blatant lies that you see that go on by a federal agency, by a federal agency that we are supposed to be monitoring and be supported by, as Indian people, as Native people, we don't know where to turn. And so in 77, people went to the United Nations. And they fought, and they still fight for the rights of indigenous peoples and the human dignity of our people. And so, just to let you know for me, that's how I grew up as a young man. And then later, you know, people call me an activist, I just say I'm an Indian, you know. That's what we do, right? We fight for our people. So what you saw is that sadly Peltier is still there. I just talked to Jean. She said she saw him in July and that he was in good spirits. He put out a statement on Standing Rock, and he releases statements periodically. If you go online, you'll find his artwork. It's for sale. It's expensive. I would love a piece, but he sent me a napkin. That's all I wrote. And I had the ability to talk to him during that tribunal in 2008, and never met him, but he's always been a hero to me. And sadly, people die in our community, and people die unwarranted deaths. And when the agents came on to look for Jimmy Eagle, who stole boots, you really think FBI agents are looking for a guy who stole boots? Yeah, I don't know. So anyway, so my criticism of the FBI runs deep. Even as our positions at the UN, we try to call out the United States on their human rights violations with indigenous populations here. Obama just yesterday said that we'll let Standing Rock play out for 2 weeks. Play out for 2 weeks. I don't know what play out means, but we know what NoDAPL is doing or what DAPL is doing. We know that Energy Partners doesn't care. They violated the 20-mile buffer zone. They violated NAGPRA. They violated the American Indian Religious Freedom Act. They violated the Historic Preservation Act. They violate constantly. And they say this is land that's owned by them. But we know that nobody owns this land but indigenous peoples. Indigenous peoples literally own this land that we're on. You can't, there's no argument about that. All of us, even me, in Los Angeles is a visitor to the Tongva and the Chumash. I'm a visitor, and I see myself as that. And so I walk lightly on this earth right here, because I respect that, and we have to respect that. If you don't, you're never gonna understand what it means to have place. And many of us don't have place. We think we have place. We buy into this real estate system. We buy and take into this capitalistic system. And we constantly put our hands over our eyes when justice is supposed to be served. And indigenous peoples are struggling continually to find that justice or what justice looks like. Do we do it internationally? We've lost here. 80% of our cases in the Supreme Court and Ninth Circuit Court are lost. 80%. In some jails, Arizona, 52% Indian population. So, you tell me, why does this matter? It matters because our people matter, our kids matter, our generations matter, our children matter, my grandchild matters, my nephews and nieces, they matter. They matter. You know, we hear all these things about Black Lives Matter, but Red Lives Matter. And we say water matters, and plant life matters, and all these things matter. So, this is heavy on all of us that have been here. Leonard got the full weight of the FBI, and they lied nearly every chance they got. They can fabricate it. They can do that easily. And sadly, our brother, our uncle, who I call an uncle, is in prison. And I pray that he'll get out. I pray. He always says he's free. His mind is spirit, but his body is behind bars. So remember that when we think about that. And, I don't know, any questions? I know we only got a few minutes, and
any questions about the latest with Peltier or kind of where everybody's at right now, and even Standing Rock, because this is connected, guys. This is connected. Yes?
There's a petition that we can sign.
There's always been a petition. It's been circulating for many, many years there. Now, there are thousands and thousands of signatures. We've met the limit to have this, to have Peltier's case reviewed by not only the judicial system, but the Congress, but by even, because that's where it's at right now. It's in Obama's hands. It's in, it's a presidential pardon that can happen. But we've met the limit. I'm not saying not to sign it. Get on there and sign it. Add your name, especially you younger folks. Add your name. If you're a voter in this system, add your name. Add your name to it. If you're not a voter, add your name to it. You know, but do it, because we're always looking for to get him out. So,
what are the action steps you suggest that we should consider?
So, you know, there's constant rallies. There's always, in South Dakota, they have a large gathering for him during July month. His case in this, which is interesting, is this is called Native American Heritage Month.
Right.
And somebody posted the other day on Facebook, this, these cops, you know, macing all these Native guys, and they go, Happy Native American Month.
Oh, yeah.
And that's really ironic to see that, no? And so there's constant marches, bring folks out here. Kathy Peltier lives here, and Anne Begay, who was the wife of Peltier. So bring folks, constantly talk about it. Bring it up in your classes. Talk about it in your gender classes. Talk it about in your race and violence classes. Talk it about in politics. Talk about it in violence, structural violence classes. I mean, Peltier's name should be at the tip of all our tongues, because this is not just a Native issue. It is a Black issue, it's a white issue, it's whatever. But most Americans are ignorant. Look at Trump. I'm kidding, but sorry if you're voting for Trump. But look at that kind of dynamic, right? That the people that support an individual like him, hate mongering violence against people, that's that kind of whiteness, right, that we always kind of talk about it at the fray, right? We don't really talk about it, and we have to talk about it, because that's violence, that's oppression. And once our white brothers and sisters learn about that violence that their ancestors caused, we don't blame, but we get you to recognize. Because once you recognize, then you take a step back and say, I'm right behind you, brother. I'm going to help you, or I'm right beside you. I always say, we don't need allies, we need accomplices. We need people that are going to stand next to us. Get arrested. And I always, you know, you guys heard me say this a few times, especially the Indian folk, is go to Standing Rock, get arrested. But those of you that can go to Standing Rock, get arrested. Because what that does is it challenges the legal system. It challenges that legal system that they say they have established, but then it also challenges the treaty violations. It challenges them and say, okay, well, prove that you own this land. How do you own this land? If you got two treaties, 1851 and 68, that say that this belongs to indigenous peoples, challenge that legal system at every corner. Peltier's been doing it. Kunstler, by the way, he passed away. But he never lost a case. One of the most prolific legal teams developed. Never lost a case. Lost his case.
Oh.
No. Amazing, brilliant man. If you ever read up on some of his legal briefings, sheesh, smart. Anybody else?
Oh, I don't know.
Can I grab my water back here, brother? Sorry.
I don't quite know where to begin, but just as a member of the white society,
yeah.
I'm kind of hot with shame watching this, because I realize, you know, that I grew up during this time and I was so oblivious to the fact that this happened, and even now,
right.
You know, I've come to some kind of understanding of what's going on with indigenous people, really from being outside this country in Latin America,
sure.
and and coming into contact with the indigenous movements and then realizing that it's going on here in my own country. And then I watch this movie and I feel like it's a rerun. And I'm wondering, you know, like I feel like everything that I've seen happening at Standing Rock and the reports in the press about the violence, you know, is like following an exact pattern of what happened just a few decades ago, you know. So I think that it's really, really important for people to understand. And you know, it's so easy to go through. I mean, it's not like people are willfully blind. People have to be willfully knowledgeable, you know, because unless you make a huge effort, there is a screen that hides this from white America. And so even as Standing Rock begins to press the, you know, rise above that screen or rise through that screen, it's like it's the first time it's ever happened. But it just happened. It happens all the time. You know, what the genocide of indigenous people is not something that happened at the birth of our country. It's something that continuously happens. And I don't know, I think this story is an important story to be told at this moment so that maybe it doesn't happen again in exactly the same way with different names.
So I want to read you something that I was just sent. Leonard Peltier has been in prison for 14,881 days, 14 hours, 40 minutes, 7, 8, 9, 10 seconds. It's happening right now. On this page. That's how long this guy's been, our brother's been in prison.
Is he in solitary?
No, he's in population, but he pretty much stays to himself. And a few years ago, there was a couple of guys who jumped Peltier. They heard him. He's an older man. They were Native men. And so what happens is you have guards and detention officers. By the way, I work in the prisons in Arizona. And if I failed to mention that, I run ceremony for the men. So I lodge it for the men and women in Arizona, three prisons and three units. But and right now, currently, Lenny Foster is the spiritual advisor for Peltier. But what the guards do and what some of the DOs do is they'll pit each other against. And they'll say, I'll give you more money on your books. I'll give you more snacks. I'll give you more time out in the yard, whatever. So you got guys who are doing life for 25 or 30, 40 years, you know, and that's the kind of mentality. But that's a sickness that unfortunately has been running through indigenous communities. High unemployment, high drug addiction, high violence in our communities. Remember, indigenous peoples didn't have jails, right? We never had jails. I mean, my people didn't, and I know a lot about indigenous peoples in this country and in Central and South America. I've had the privilege to travel that far, and there were systems that were in place, and these were systems that were based on traditional knowledge teachings. And we don't have any of those, and it's because we're always being compared, right, to that, to the American standards, whatever that is. And all of us are, not just us. I mean, you guys too. All of you guys are trying to get up there. I mean, the genocide continues. I mean, the United States refuses to use that term, the genocide. Obama doesn't say it, presidents don't say it. Leaders at the United Nations will say it to the UN, and most other leaders throughout the world will say it. We label them radicals or dysfunctional leaders.
But the UN is starting to get involved in Standing Rock, is that
well, right? They did send, I believe it was, he's a delegate and a member of the United Nations Permanent Forum on Indigenous Peoples. So Vicky Tolikorpos, you guys should know this name, she is the special rapporteur
for the Indigenous, for the United Nations Permanent Forum. I know him too, and I forgot his name, but he's headed over there. The question is how good is the UN going to do there, right? So if the UN don't send troops, which the United States will have a fit about, right? They'll like, then they'll bring helicopters and the jets and they'll say, oh, you know. So it's going to be crazy. But he is an observer. He'll go there and see. But United States is the largest contributor to the United Nations, 60-70% in some cases on food and aid and military. So yeah. I mean, we're always been, and we're probably always, not always, but we're going to be stuck between a rock and a hard place. And as Indigenous peoples, that's really, really difficult to find yourself. And the frustration and the tears and the anger you feel, imagine how a lot of us feel about that almost daily when we see Standing Rock, or we go back home. Or if you're African American, you see that in the communities at your home. I mean, you can roll down the street in Crenshaw and Compton and Long Beach, and you see poverty is piled on poverty, and it's like, geez, you know, this system is meant to keep you down. So what do? Revolution, man. Change it. Change it. Seriously. Seriously. And a revolution is not, you know, I mean, you know, we can all get militant and get all crazy. I'm not going to say, Shannon's telling everybody to get militant at UCLA. But what I will say is decolonize your mindset. Decolonize it first, because it begins there. And when you start to do that, and when you start to talking to your white relatives and your friends, you go to church, say it. I mean, the Unitarian Church had us speak at one of their largest gatherings. 4,000 Unitarians speak about Peltier, oppression, colonization. Does the Catholic Church talk about it? No, they still honor the doctrines of discovery that we use in our court system. Yes?
What was the most effective form of pressure that got the pardon on Clinton's desk, and do you think it would still work now?
Well, you know, the good thing is about Obama, I mean, there's a couple of good things, but I say that with a grain of salt, because this political system to me is just, he's so embedded in this colonial system that it erases everything. It erases everybody, people of color. So you have to accept that system, right? And that's where Obama is. He has to accept what's already been in place, stand for the flag, be patriotic, be whatever, you know? Don't be Colin Kaepernick, you know, that kind of stuff, right? Don't be the guy with the fist in the air, just kind of go along, right? So Obama has said on a couple of occasions, F you to some of the Congress folks, right? He doesn't have to ask anyone. He's pardoned and released 90-something prisoners already, long-term. Some of them are not that big of crimes. I mean, they're drug, mostly drug-related. But all he has to do is sign, and nobody will challenge that. The FBI might. He's going out. He's going.
What's keeping him from doing it?
Wow. Yeah, I mean, that's you want 500 years of that answer, or you want 200 years of colonization? I don't know. I mean, you know, there's a lot of things keeping him. I mean, he has the opportunity to do that right now. He can sign it right now. And he could say, you know what? He's done. And if you look at Peltier's case at that time in the 70s, if you committed a murder, the longest term you could get was anywhere from 25 years, and that was it. Yeah. 25 years. Now, but at that time, they again violated another policy that they had and gave him double life. I don't know. It's a mess, folks. But I mean, seriously, if Leonard Peltier is not at the tip of your tongue when you're talking about these issues, about colonization, race, violence, gender violence, whatever you're talking about, if he's not at that case, and even Mahmoud, right? I mean, he's in prison. Our Black Panther brother, he's in prison. You know, that's a whole big question itself.
Yeah.
I mean, so political prisoners. in this country, and Peltier is one of the longest serving ones. And sadly, I pray for my brother that he comes out, our uncle comes out, and Obama will do the right thing, but who knows, you know. We can see how Standing Rock looks, we can see how Oak Flat looks, we can see what Mauna Kea looks like, we can see all these activities all over indigenous communities. 80% of the world's resources are stuck still on indigenous people's territories. The best. That's why they're trying to get them. Whether it's in Bagua in Peru, or Guatemalan War, or Honduras, Bertha Carasas, they just killed her. And during the time in the 70s, and I'll just end with this, is that there was a woman, a Flying Eagle woman, who was killed in Guatemala. She was native, she was Mi'kmaq from the east coast of this country. And she was killed by the FARC. But at that time, and I'm gonna give this information to you, at that time, the Rockefeller family had the opportunity to pay $1 million to have her released. $1 million was nothing to the Rockefeller family. And they didn't pay. She didn't die. She didn't die because somebody shot her or killed her. She died from a spider bite. But the other persons that were with her, they were killed because they were with her. They were other Native men. She was an indigenous observer, a Native indigenous observer who went to look at the struggles in Guatemala. And right now we know that in Guatemala, 90% of the land is owned by 6 families, mostly Italian and German. Sheesh. I don't know, people, it's tough, but we got one more question and we gotta hit up.
You spoke on it. This is not just the Native issue. Mm-hmm. How important is Red and Black solidarity to the benefit and hopefully the sooner than later liberation of indigenous people?
Well, it depends. Back in the day, the Black Panther movement, and me and some of the Black Panther guys had a discussion about this, is that indigenous peoples were looking for civil rights. We were looking for indigenous rights. Because we're separate from that system. We have our own sovereign status. The African American community was looking at the time for civil rights, whether it was Martin Luther King, even some of the talks from Malcolm X, but he was a little bit far more to the right than King. But even the Black Panther movement, they were looking for these civil rights. We were looking for indigenous rights. And that's the distinction. But to your point, is that if we don't, people of color, and I'm not just talking Black folks, I'm talking brown folks, some of our Mexicano brothers, and even some of our white accomplices, if you don't stand together, this fight will not go very far. Because the oppression is so strong by the state, this member state of the UN, this United States, that they will do everything to continue to oppress you. Because right now, oligarchs, private international corporations, multinational corporations, extractive industries are in the pockets of many, many politicians. And you can Google them, and you can see whose pockets they're in. But us as people of color, if the Black folks and the brown folks, we don't get together, and I'm not saying doing an armed revolution, but it's really difficult for me, as an older brother who's been involved in this movement for since I was a kid, to not go to Standing Rock and go, you can't violate my people like that, right? Because you're hurting them, you're literally shooting at them. You know, and you got snipers and people fully armed pointing guns at you. It's hard for me not to do that. I'm not telling you to do that. But I am saying that something drastically in this country has to change. Whether it was we take examples from the 60s, but then you got COINTELPRO. And you got COINTELPRO happening right now in Standing Rock.
You got folks infiltrating the camp. You got folks who say, I'm Indian, I'm down with the Indians, man. And there are some of our white brothers who want to see the dismantling of that camp. And it's slowly happening. People are being asked to leave. People are being asked to leave the camp and saying, oh, well, you know, and they're native people, right? Because somebody planted in the mind, somebody else said, that's a bad person. And that person is usually somebody working for that other side. That's how it works. And we've seen that with the American Indian Movement and the dismantling of, by and large, the movement at the time. So you really gotta be aware of who you're talking to, what you're talking about, and what you're sharing. It's happening all the time. When I travel, whether it's to Central and South America, we're always detained. We're always held back and said, oh, what are you doing there? Why are you over there? We're helping the Indian people, man. You know? So, luckily for me, I have a couple of, you know, IDs that I carry around if I travel that far. And one of them is this one. No, I don't. But anyway, man, you know, thanks you guys, thanks for coming. I'm glad you came.